Hang on. Okay, thanks for having me in today, guys. Thanks for the invitation, Aaron. You guys have a really nice school. I got to take a chance to look at it a couple weeks back, and it's pretty amazing. I wish I could have gone to a place like this. My name is Jacob Walker. I'm an independent artist and illustrator. About 3 years ago, I switched from doing graphic design and pre-press stuff for printing companies and started doing freelance work full-time, mainly for game clients, doing card art and role-playing game books, board games, that sort of stuff. And then earlier this year, I jumped in with a Kickstarter project. I wanted to make my own book, kind of try my own thing. And that's what I wanted to talk to you guys about today, about all the benefits that Kickstarter has for us as creatives and all the different things you can get out of it. Okay, so for Kickstarter, like, you want to take something you're pretty passionate about. You find your the thing you've been wanting to make forever, that comic that you've been thinking about, or the short video. You know, you find your passion project and try and sift through Kickstarter and find other projects similar to it to start getting research and stuff. And once you kind of narrow in on what it is you want to do, try and find a product that you can match up with your project. That way you can better research it and pull like some parameters from what the project is. For example, what I did was make a book. So once I decided I wanted to make a book, I was able to look at other campaigns and start saying, this is how they did their campaign, this is the sort of money they were asking for. And it also let me start looking at different vendors, different book printers and stuff like that, and to start reverse engineering so that instead of having that kind of foggy idea that I wanted to make, I could now start making real decisions on it. You know, do I want to make it 9x12? Do I want to make it 8.5x11? Started realizing, you know, 8.5x11 is still a good size, but it also weighs less, which affects the shipping, which then affects your overall cost of things. So one of the key things for running a good Kickstarter is really putting in a lot of time at the beginning to research it and make sure that, for one, the project that you want to take into product mode is something that you can kind of see has been successful in the past. It's something that you can feel pretty confident is going to work. And, you know, maybe your initial idea, you can't find a good example of it working, and you go back and retool it until you feel like you've got something that you've got a pretty good chance of not only meeting your funding goal, but going past it. Basically all the work's in the preparation for your campaign. There's tons of stuff to consider on the campaign. There's so many different moving parts that all sort of tie in together. For me and for other people I've talked to, you just kind of start with your initial idea and you just keep going back and revising how you're going to do it and looking at different vendors and stuff and keep working on your numbers until you can kind of get in a place where everything lines up pretty well. You got to think about what your overall goal is, your financial goal. You got to make sure you get enough to produce like the minimum amount. So a lot of times that starts with looking at for like the book. I'll keep coming back to that as my example. I've looked at minimum quantities for the printer, like how many books I had to get made, so that affects the cost. I don't necessarily think that maybe I would go through all those, so what's the other minimums to consider? Start thinking about, like, I can buy packaging in bulk at this amount, and then I start looking at other campaigns saying they've got a similar book they made, they got, you know, maybe 200 backers, maybe I should start thinking mine is comparable, so I should expect around 200. And just kind of play with the numbers as I go. and try and figure out my goal from that. I'll get more into that in another slide where I actually break down some of the parts more. And then you also have to look at reward levels. There's a lot of different ways you can kind of structure your reward levels, but you want to have a nice range, some cheap ones for the people that don't have a lot of money to put in, and you also want to put some really high dollar ones in. You'll be amazed, someone just out of nowhere will drop $1,000 on someone's project just so that they can have a painting done that goes in the book, or you can put original art in there. I had a $700 piece go through the campaign that, you know, was pretty nice. And thinking about the rewards too, you want to, as part of your research, you got to find what you think the average backer would be on comparable projects. That's kind of a hard thing to calculate, so it ends up being kind of a best guess. And see, fulfillment, you want to design quick and easy fulfillment. I'll talk about that a bit more. Dates, you want to make sure to set your project up so it's not competing with any other dates, like the launch date shouldn't be like around a holiday or like when the Super Bowl is. You want to make sure people can get to it pretty easily without, you know, being on summer vacation and stuff like that. Let's see, I'll get into budgeting in another slide too. Advertising is something to consider. You can get on some blogs and spend like maybe $100-$150 to get advertising, and you usually get your money back out of that pretty easily. Add-ons are another thing to consider. In addition to your rewards, you can make it so people can add on stuff. There's just a whole bunch of moving parts that you have to consider. So kind of starting at the beginning here, you need to find what your base level of support is. So for my book, I looked at how much the books cost to be printed. While doing the research, I started noticing coloring books were probably a good idea, so I repurposed the artwork from the book and made it into a coloring book as well, which actually ended up outselling the book, so that was a good thing I learned from the research I'd done through Kickstarter. I offered prints with stuff. I knew I was going to add stickers and postcards and bookmarks in as reward level, or as stretch goals and stuff along the way. So I wanted to price those into to my original pricing structure so that later on it couldn't potentially break all the numbers I'd set up. There's just tons of little things. You gotta price all of them out. Stuff like putting the ISBN number in it, looking at all your packaging, your mailers, your printing labels, all that stuff. You need to really figure out every single expense you can think of for it and try and get a base number. Like mine here is based off of some of the minimum quantities, and I decided I needed, I think it was like around 6,400 or whatever. So I just bumped it up to 7,000 to kind of pad it a little bit. It's always gonna be something that comes up, something you don't account for. So you wanna build a little bit of that in. It's nice to build a little bit in to, you know, buy pizza and drinks and stuff for friends that help you pack the stuff up. Me, I paid my kids to like do some of the packing, and it's good as long as they don't mess it up, right? So while you're researching other people's projects, I was looking at average pledge amounts, and I kind of settled in on around $35 as being pretty normal for a book. So then I used that to then figure out how many backers I needed. And just looking at all the examples of other people that had done similar projects, everything lined up where it looked like I could easily cover my cost. I could pretty easily hit that $35 average backer level, and I could easily go over the 285 backers that it looked like I needed. And also I've got shipping and postage figured in there, and came out with my grand total of needing 10,000. just so happened two other people were launching very similar projects right at the same time as me. Wish we'd known and we would have talked about stuff prior, but we all ended up asking for about the same amount of money and shot for pretty much the same goals, and we all ended up within a couple thousand of each other. So I felt like all the research I'd done led, or all three of us, it all led us to about the same place. So really getting a good idea for what other people have done and trying to dissect how they've done it can help you out. And really, it all comes down to doing the research and making sure you've got a good plan going into it. Because once you launch it, if something's broken and if your project takes off, it can grow exponentially. For example, I screwed up my postage. My international postage, I charged too little for it, so I lost money on that. Luckily, I accidentally overcharged just a little bit for US postage and it balanced out. But if you get any of that wrong and your campaign just runs away, you could potentially lose money. There's plenty of examples of people putting a book on Kickstarter and it doing phenomenally well, and then they start adding, like, here's a second book, here's a third book, here's a fourth book, without realizing you just quadrupled the weight of your package that you're mailing. And I've seen companies go in debt and bankrupt because they've screwed up that bad on one minor detail. So the planning phase is definitely the most important for this. Once you've got it all figured out and set, then it's basically keeping up with questions and trying to interact with everybody. So to get into your reward levels, I guess I kind of got into that a little bit before, but you want a nice range of them. You don't want to have like tons and tons of them, because I know I get tired of looking at projects that have like 20, 30 levels to them. But try and make one that's supposed to be like right around the average pledge that you want, and try and make it a nice level. Make the ones below it, you know, something nice too, but you always want to try and make it so that you encourage people to upsell and get a little bit higher than that average level you're going after. You can include all kinds of stuff in this. One of my levels was just a PDF version of my books, which works out great because there's no actual production cost there. Anytime you can put any kind of digital rewards in, that's really good for you because it kind of cuts out production cost. And like, I ended up offering the PDF version along with the physical version, just so the people, like with the coloring book, they didn't have to tear up the coloring book, they could just print out the page. It also meant I could send them out immediately after the books were ready instead of waiting on printing and shipping. Especially when you're doing international stuff, that can take a while, and that makes people happy when they get stuff sooner. And really want to make sure you keep everybody happy because you're trying to build a fan base with this. Yeah, upselling, you can do other things for that, like each time you kind of go up a tier, you add maybe two things to it instead of one, just so that the value keeps going up and encourage people to go that extra little bit. Designing for easy fulfillment, that's another lesson I learned out of doing it wrong. With several of the levels on mine, I had it set up where you get these books and a choice of print, which basically turned all those orders into custom orders. So I had to look through each one and make sure, okay, this person wants this print with these. And there were a bunch of people that didn't tell me which print, which meant I had to follow up with them. So really keeping an eye on making everything as streamlined and easy for you and for the backer is just very, very good practice for this. Especially like if you're going to do a first one, make it simple, make it super clean and easy to run. And you can try different things, but keeping it simple is usually best. Also, you can limit some tiers. Like I had a sketch edition where I do a sketch in front of a book, and within like a week or so, I hit 50 on that, and I realized I didn't want to let that go for a full month, because that could take up a lot of time. So I put a cap on that, and I know some other people that didn't, and they spent a couple months doing sketches in their books afterwards. So you can use that to your advantage. Selling original art, I found that I was able to sell almost every single piece out of these books through the campaign. I had one tier where I just said, you get the books plus one original black and white drawing. And people bought them without seeing them, which kind of blew me away. But I blew through that pretty quick, which told me that my pricing was probably kind of low, and that what I'm used to going to conventions and trying to sell art that way, those people, I guess, don't spend as much on it. If you're reaching a larger audience, you're more likely to get people that are willing to put more money down on this. So don't be too scared to kind of up prices on original stuff a little bit, I'd say, whenever it's going on Kickstarter. Another thing you can do is put like one or two pieces on there and use them as a way to point people towards other online stores you have. Say, I've got this piece here, if you like it, like the other art from the book, I've also got more on Etsy or on my site. And you can kind of utilize your campaign as a good way to point people to other places where you have stuff. Stretch goals. Lots of campaigns have stretch goals. Try and plan those out before you start, and usually include those in your original estimates, especially when it comes to shipping and everything. You can use your stretch goals also as a way to incentivize people to upsell. You don't have to do it for the entire campaign. Like, you can just say, if we reach X amount of dollars, we'll add stickers to everyone that's on the $35 and up tier, which will encourage people to bump their pledge up, maybe another 10 bucks or something. So we talked a little bit about what you're making and how you're making it, but a big part of Kickstarter is telling the story of why you're making it, why it's important to you, why it's important to them. And I think one of the big things about crowdfunding in general that appeals to people is they feel like they're actually helping you make this thing real. It's real easy to get on like Amazon and order something or pre-order something. Like, I made this book, you can find other books like it for way cheaper on Amazon, but part of what makes it neat for people to back is because they get to watch you go through the process, they get to know you. They feel more connected to it, which is great because, again, wanting to use this as a way to build fans. You want to make your thing, you know, and get paid for it, but you also want to look at the bigger picture of how to make those people become your fans and follow you and possibly buy into your vision and future projects you have. They feel like they have a helping hand, and you want to make it personal. You know, don't just say, here's what I made, please give me money so that I can print it. People do that, but whenever you put a good story with it, it seems to go better. There's an artist here in Chicago. She had a campaign not too long ago that was amazing. She just had her second kid, and she was a stay-at-home mom, and she was getting frustrated because she couldn't do very much artwork anymore. So her whole campaign was saying the struggle she goes through to be able to find time to make the art, and how she filled up this moleskin drawing every night and just made this wonderful campaign out of it. The artwork would have sold it alone, but whenever she put the story to it, just instantly felt more connected to it and to her, and it did really well. So, okay, I keep going back to the creating fans. Making that connection is very much a good part of crowdfunding. It's also good to mention your credentials. It's very much a trust thing whenever someone decides to back your project. You know, especially if it's your first one, you're untested, they don't know, you know, if you can deliver or not. So it's good to say, you know, I've made books in the past for clients, I've loved it, I've really enjoyed doing that, and now I want to make one for myself. You know, I've done the graphic design part, I've illustrated, I've worked at a printing company, I understand all the steps, and I'm really excited to be able to do this and take you guys on the journey with me. And you're selling the story of it, and you're telling them that you can deliver on it, you know how, you've done it before. So, kind of giving a little bit of background on yourself and why they should be able to trust you, you know, plays into the overall narrative and helps sell you and the project. Finding your audience is a big thing too. If you just make something and put it on there, it will get eyes on it because there's a lot of traffic that's comes just from Kickstarter. But if you can start off with kind of a plan ahead of time, you can really kind of ramp up how many people see it. With mine, my whole book started off as a daily drawing project, kind of like Inktober, if you guys know what that is. I just started doing a drawing every day. I had like a new Pinterest account, or not Pinterest, Tumblr and Instagram, and I was trying to populate that. Pretty quickly, I realized it's going to turn into a project, but I just kept posting that daily picture, and people started commenting like, hey, I really look forward to this every day. This is pretty neat. And then by the time I realized I was making a book and had some details worked out, I was able to say, you know, I've been having a blast making these. I'm going to try and put them in a book later on in a few months or something, and probably put it on Kickstarter, and instantly got a lot of feedback from people saying that they liked it. And that they definitely keep an eye out for it. So I was using that for those accounts, and I also started going to places where the source material for my book would go over well. I did a book on Lovecraft and all his monsters and stuff, and there's tons of fans of that out there, so I started searching out groups for that and dropping an image, you know, in this Facebook group or that Facebook group every other day or so, and kind of building up a little bit of following as I was working my way through making the book before I'd even announced it was a book and before I put it on Kickstarter. But I just kept kind of feeding stuff out there to kind of build interest. And you can really do that in a ton of different places. And the way I look at it is they're all different funnels that can feed into your campaign or feed into your website. You can really point them wherever you want. And trying to get a bunch of these that maybe don't overlap, all these different pools of people with the least amount of overlap is great. Try and get outside of your bubble of friends. I know that was one thing I really wanted to do with this, was not hit up all my friends and family and say, hey, please give me money. I wanted to know if this would actually fly with people I didn't know. So I was really trying to reach out beyond people I knew. And you just gotta try to get it out there in as many places as possible to get as many eyes on it as possible. So you've done all that, you think you're prepared, you've done all your homework, you've kinda let everybody know, you've given an announcement to everyone saying, you know, I'm gonna start it on this date. That'll wear you out like crazy going through all that. But as soon as you hit the launch button, you just get all kinds of energy and you're all crazy about it. And you really need to clear off your schedule for that first week, first couple weeks, because you will just sit there and hit the reload button over and over. And you're also going to be fielding a lot of questions from people that want to know specifics about the campaign or have suggestions for you. And trying to interact with them as much as you can, because I'll just keep coming back to it again and again. You want to make fans of these people. You want them to come back to you for other projects you work on. So really talk to them, try and get to know them. So trying to manage your time with this, really that first week, first few days especially, but that first week eats up a lot of time. in the middle it starts slowing down, and usually the way it works, the first 2 days and the last 2 days of the campaign are the busiest. Those 4 days in total usually account for half of your total Kickstarter funds raised. Everything in the middle just sort of levels off. So anything you can do to draw attention to those middle days is good. If you have any announcements, I had planned to try and get like a fairly well-known author to write a foreword for my book. In the end it fell through, but the idea was make that announcement like a week into the campaign to bring new life into it, and also by bringing that person into it, you can bring their followers into it to funnel them into your campaign. And you can do that in other ways too. You can invite a guest artist to maybe contribute a print or something to it, and you know, you pay them for what they've done, but you're also getting access to their followers. So anything you can do to kind of break up that middle section by drawing other people in, getting reviews on blogs and stuff like that is also a really good thing. Spend your time emailing people saying, you know, can I get featured on your blog, or can you post me on your Tumblr? I'd really appreciate it. Especially if you're a big fan of their site and been following them for a while, you know, you can have a good conversation with them. Just try and go through those announcements and break up that middle section as much as you can. And as much as you can keep, you know, the curve of that graph going upward and keep building fast, you tend to gain momentum that way. If you guys have been on Kickstarter and you see a campaign that, you know, is on like day 19 or day 20 and it's, you know, 60% funded, doesn't have any momentum, really doesn't have a lot of excitement, so you want to try and, you know, blow past your goal as quick as you can, and then just keep the appearance of this is going great and going up, because that will help keep backers excited. Another good thing to do is send out weekly updates. Kickstarter's got a pretty good way of sending updates out so that you can send it out to all your backers or just certain levels. You can make it anonymous, or not anonymous, but so that only backers can see it. And just giving them progress updates is really good. It lets them know you're still working on it, that you're being attentive to their questions. It just ups their level of confidence that you're going to follow through and make this happen and satisfy everything you said you'd do. Making those updates so that they can be seen publicly too while a campaign is live is nice, because people can kind of see behind the curtain a little bit and see what you're doing, and it might interest them a little bit more and be another reason why they might decide to go ahead and back. And yeah, again, keep trying to build relationships with these people. If you get anybody that backs like some of the higher dollar stuff, send them an email. Say hi and try and get to know them a little bit better. I was talking to one of the guys that backed mine. I found out he bought a painting from a friend of mine too. So we got to have a bit of discussion about that. And just try and make it personal as much as you can. So you go through the campaign, make it to the end, and that again kind of wears you out, but the whole thing is kind of like this crazy endurance marathon. And then you get to the fulfillment part. As soon as the campaign ends, if you have your project done and you're able to send out surveys to everybody you can that ask all the basic questions like, what's your address and phone number for shipping information, what's your email in case I need to send you any kind of digital rewards. Then you get to ask other questions on there, like, you know, if you did have a choice of this or that, you know, what option you want, if you had a t-shirt on there or something, what size. Again, offering stuff that has the least amount of options is usually best for you, but that's a good place to ask all those. Also in mine, I asked, like, you know, since you're giving me your email address for this, would you also like to sign up for my mailing list so that I can let you know about any future projects? And I probably had a good 400 or 500 people join my mailing list from that. And those are quality names to have on the list because they've already put money into your project, so you know they value your work. About 10 to 14 days after the campaign ends, the money gets released to you from Kickstarter. At that point, you can start ordering everything from your vendors. It's good to talk to your vendors ahead of time and make sure that they know that you're going to be ready on this date and that they can still produce stuff by that certain date. And, you know, if they need to order more paper or do whatever, they're prepared. Third-party solutions. There's a lot of extra add-ons, too. If you do a campaign, you'll find that out real quick. People come out of the woodwork saying, you know, I can do this for you and do that for you, and most of it's garbage. There's a handful out there. Backer Kit's one that's good to look into, and it actually lets you add on stuff after the campaign ends. If someone comes to your Kickstarter page, which stays up forever, I think, for a really long amount of time, they come in after the campaign, they can go ahead and pre-order. So if they miss the campaign, they can still get it. You can send out multiple surveys to them through that. So some of these third-party things that you can tack on after the fact are actually really good. Backer Kit, I know, pays for itself. I didn't use it, and after I found out about it, I wish I would have. Sounds like it adds to the experience, and also some people buy a lot of stuff off Kickstarter. I was amazed at how many people back like 50, 60 projects. And when they see that backer kit on there, that's usually a sign that you've kind of gone the extra mile. You're trying to make this more customer friendly. And just that alone is kind of a good sign. As you're shipping stuff out, you know you're going to have some damages. Try and pack stuff as good as you can. I feel like the Postal Service did a pretty good job. I sent out, I don't know, probably 850 packages, and there were quite a few damages, but it probably only ended up being like 2%, and I only had to replace maybe 20 books total, which I thought was pretty good. It's kind of good to build a little bit of that into your initial campaign, just know that it's going to happen and be prepared for it, and if someone gets a bad product in the mail, replace it for them. Just make sure they're happy, because again, you want them to be happy with the entire experience and you want them to come back to you in the future. And also, when you come to the end of it, just flat out ask your backers to follow you. Say, you know, if you've enjoyed this and you like the art, you like what I made, you know, please follow me on social media or sign up for my mailing list if you haven't already. So probably ran through that kind of quick. You can go into tons and tons of detail on this stuff. That's kind of the broad overview. What I think gets missed in the discussion a lot, like if you start looking at videos online about Kickstarter, they dive into all the numbers and stuff, which is great. But after the campaign, you can really use the successful campaign as a way to launch yourself forward into other things. So, what have you gained from it? People look at you now and they see you've made this thing, you've done good with it. You know, if you really surpass your goal, you look just way more successful and they're more likely to follow you on stuff in the future. Work opportunities end up happening. I had several people contact me while I was making this, asking, you know, could you do some illustrations for my book? Or, you know, could we maybe license that image to put on whatever over here? So just having that visibility will draw people to you. I started doing conventions recently and I started noticing that there too. If you just put yourself out there and make yourself publicly available, people will start coming to you instead of you tracking down art directors and pestering them. People will see the stuff and come to you. And this has actually kind of affected my client work. Some of my clients, you know, they'd ask me to do something for them and I'd look at what they're offering for me pay-wise, and I'd look at their contract, and it'd be kind of restrictive. I wouldn't be able to share the artwork for several months until the project's out, or I wouldn't be able to keep the rights to the project. And I'd be able to say, well, that's a nice project, I'd love to help, but I've just proven I can make my own thing, retain the rights to it, and you know, I've created that asset that I can make money off of in a lot of different ways instead of just doing a one-time paycheck for the client work. So this has really kind of given me a new perspective on client work and really encouraged me to kind of go the independent route. And in the future, I'm going to try and do a book a year and try and start building up a whole host of assets that I can use to try and make a living off of. And while doing that, that gives me more choice in what freelance work I take. Some of you guys will probably go after like a studio job, and you can even work some of this into that. Being able to kind of course correct your portfolio as you get into your career, taking that studio job can kind of dictate where your portfolio goes, and maybe you want to kind of retool your portfolio and aim towards a different path at some point, you know. Finding time to do that's really difficult, and Kickstarter can be a good way to kind of correct that and get to produce what you want and get paid for it and justify spending the time on it. So it can actually help your portfolio too that way. And you guys as students getting out looking for jobs and stuff, having a good portfolio or a good Kickstarter thing in your portfolio actually says, you know, I can think beyond just, you know, making a great image. I've, you know, looked at the entire package from start to finish. You know, I had to reverse engineer my way back from this book to what kind of art I needed for it, you know, what kind of copy goes with it in the book and who it gets marketed to. So it kind of shows a broader awareness of shows that you have a broader awareness. Lovely graphic here shows my art skills. Getting paid multiple times is something that I've really been trying to figure out as an artist as well. Having worked as a freelancer for the past 3 years, a lot of my clients, you know, pay you that one time for the job. You don't retain any rights to it afterwards or get any royalties. So if you don't get paid a lot for it, it gets difficult to live job to job. So I started trying to figure out how can I get paid multiple times. So in this case, I made a book and put it on Kickstarter, got paid once there. Now that that's complete, I'll put it on print-on-demand places. A buddy of mine repurposed some art from one of his books and made a coloring book, an activity book, put it on Amazon, and start off making 30, 40 bucks a month, not a big deal, but then he just watched it keep getting larger and larger and larger each month. By the time he got around to Christmas, he had a $700 payout that month, which that's a mortgage payment or, you know, several school payments. So it ended up leveling off around $200 or $300. For you guys, if you think about, if you could make one project like that and get consistently $100 or $200, that could be your school payment. Getting out of school, that's something you got to think about. So trying to set up your Kickstarter, thinking about it in advance so that you can set it up in a way that you can then roll that project into others is great to create a bunch of passive income streams. Other things you can do, you can create tutorial videos and stuff. If you work digital, you can do you can make custom Photoshop brushes and texture and 3D models. All those things kind of as part of your campaign, and then you can go to sites like Gumroad, put them on there to get extra traffic, maybe you charge a little bit for them. Like Gumroad, I think they prompt you to donate even if it's free. So you can kind of use your Kickstarter as a way to build a bunch of assets to kind of just put out in a bunch of different places to create all those funnels coming back to you. Some of them will create pay, some of them just create traffic. So when you do that, when you think about Kickstarter, realize that it can be used for such a larger career view for you. Other things you can do to get paid multiple times from what you created is then maybe sell licensing rights. I know several artists that, you know, they do their paintings and they put it on their own things, they sell prints, they do all this stuff with it, and then they sell rights to, you know, stores. One woman puts her stuff in Hot Topic and Disney and makes a ton of money off that, and she's already made her money by, you know, making the original, selling the original, putting it on her own projects, selling prints of it, and really you can line up a whole string of things. There's other crowdfunding sites like Patreon. That's one I haven't got into yet. But another example, another artist here in Chicago, I know he starts his project off on Patreon. He does two paintings a month. He makes pretty good money off of just doing those two paintings. He creates a few videos, process videos, and then he feeds that over to his website where he sells prints off of that and goes to shows and sells prints at conventions. When he's got enough, he collects them, puts them in a book. That hits Kickstarter. He just did a $200,000 Kickstarter for his latest book. He spent the past 2 years making assets that he could use for this, building a following, and his work's really phenomenal. So it's not a wonder that it has paid off as well as it has, but him being smart on the business end of it, he's really enabled himself to get paid through Patreon, through his website, through Kickstarter, and he's leveraged it in a bunch of other ways. So Kickstarter is great in and of itself. Any crowdfunding site's great because it gives you more opportunities, but realize that you can use those and string them all together and make even larger opportunities for yourself. Try and treat yourself as a business first, an artist second, and make those good business decisions that enable you to be able to make artwork and be more choosy about the artwork you make instead of taking any job that comes along. And Kickstarter can be a great jumping off point for a career or reshaping your career as you get along. So that's kind of the bulk of the presentation there. Any questions from anybody?
Yeah. You mentioned a visual artist who's making videos. Is that, did I understand that?
Yeah.
What is the subject matter and what is the bottom line on that?
I've not really researched those a whole lot because I don't really work with video stuff, but I've seen plenty of campaigns where they make a short video, maybe a short animation, could be purely for entertainment. They could be doing, like, you know, the history of their small town, and your backing of it gets you, you know, maybe a download of it or maybe a physical disc. You can work that in a lot of different ways. Maybe you offer them an option to be in it, or a thank you in the credits, stuff like that. Pretty much any kind of creative endeavor you want to do, there's probably a good example out there. I've seen stuff, video, sculptures, murals, all kinds of stuff. If you've got that big passion project, just kind of get on Kickstarter or other crowdfunding sites and look around and try and get ideas of how can you turn that into a project that looks feasible and successful. And
the video will serve as a promotion or a vehicle of understanding what the project is. Most of us see video or YouTube, and that would give the Kickstarter campaign more substance.
Well, like Kickstarter usually has the video up front telling you about it, but I've seen plenty that are, you know, help me make this, you know, 30-minute long film about whatever, and they'll produce like a short film or an animation, really kind of whatever you want to do. There's examples of it out there.
Besides actually making the work, how much time would you say you would put into a project, like researching, and then like designing your product like prior to?
Depends on the scope of it, really. I mean, my project felt fairly in-depth, like I kind of jumped in a little over my head for being the first one I'd done. I felt confident in making this stuff, so I wasn't too worried about it. But I had done the, you know, crunching the numbers in a way of trying to figure out how to present it and everything. For me, I was already a good halfway through making the book before I realized, you know, that's what I was going to do with it. But I tried to get it, you know, 75, 80, 90% of the way done before I launched the campaign. That's another thing that gives people confidence that you're going to follow through and make it happen. There's kind of like two ways of people doing Kickstarter. One is, hey, I've got this idea, give me money so that I can go figure out how to make it. And then there's the, I've basically got this done, do you want to pre-order it and help me finish it off and make it a little bit better than what I originally hoped to make it. Some campaigns are real small, you can plan out in a few days. Some friends of mine have done stuff like, I've got a new piece of artwork, I want to make a limited edition print run. You know, here's a few different levels, you can back it and get, you know, a signed limited edition of this print. Maybe some other stuff we'll throw in, or a few other prints from previous stuff I've done. I've seen those do well and grab a couple thousand, which, you know, if you think about it, that's enough to pay for about a month's worth of time and stuff, and you don't really need to put that much time into a campaign like that. And if you think about it, that's a pretty good payout for a piece of art. I've seen people go on there and say, you know, I've done this series of paintings, I want to do another one, here's my thoughts on it, here's my preliminary sketches, help me fund this and you'll get, you know, a nice limited edition print of it. So sometimes it can be a way to fund the next painting you want to do. With that, it does help to have kind of a body of work and a following. Really depends on the size and scope of your project. For like mine, trying to plan it out in a day or two wasn't feasible. It's something I kind of worked out over probably a week or two, just going back and refining it as I kind of gathered more information and looked at other examples. I don't know. Is that a good answer?
Mm-hmm. Yep.
How much does Kickstarter take?
Kickstarter takes between, I think it's 5% and 10% or 7% and 10%. I don't know. Mine came out to be about 8%.
Yeah, how much you make?
Yeah, like I raised $37,000. They took the 8% right off the top, and so 33 something hit the bank account. I would recommend putting it in separate bank accounts and don't accidentally end up spending part of it. Keep it completely separate, just for your own sake. Another point on that that I just lost. A good rule of thumb, like if you can get fairly well past your goal, it starts leveling off to kind of a situation where a third of it goes to production, a third of it goes to shipping, and you end up making about a third. So if you can try and make it a decent way past your initial goal, you know, you've got a good chance of getting a decent payout. Like mine definitely paid for the amount of time I put into it. The probably 3 months or so I used leading up to it, doing all the daily drawings. I did an original painting for it, and actually used some paintings I'd done for client work that I'd kept the rights to earlier. So. Any other questions, comments?